The Wylye Valley in Wiltshire stretches for 18 memorable miles from Warminster to Wilton, the little town from which the county got its name. It's a narrow valley with a road on either side of the river and charming villages scattered in pairs along its opposing banks. This is the classic English countryside, which foreigners flock to see and of which exiled Englishmen dream. Thatch and water meadows. Trout fishing and downland. Old churches and grazing sheep. In spite of the heavy traffic on inadequate roads and the roar of the Royal Air Force, the countryside character and the village life have remained serene and beautiful, although the local people today can seldom afford to live in the houses which their forefathers built. At the head of the valley, Wilton was once the capital of ancient Wessex, a far more important place than nearby Salisbury. People have argued that it was the first capital of England. The Wylye River runs straight through the middle of the world-famous Wilton Royal Carpet Factory. The fine grazing for sheep and the abundant water have together meant that superb carpets have been made here since as far back as 1655. The business was started by French and Flemish weavers escaping from religious persecution, and it's almost certainly the oldest carpet factory in the world. Born and bred in the Wylye Valley, Violet Foyle can still weave carpets in the old style, while around her, the factory produces elegant coverings for some of the grandest floors in the world.
Oh, I've been around this area all my life, and I worked on the hand weaving for 25 years. 6 months training to do in the first place. And after that 6 months training, you were put on piecework. To set up the loom, there only used to be about three or four of us. When the whole carpet started, all 12 of us started together. Some of the girls didn't work as fast as the other ones, you know, and we sort of divided the knots out between us, you know? And when we were on piecework, we had 2,000 of these knots to put in and pull down. This is the old money I'm talking about for 1 in 7. So you see, we had to work very hard to earn any money. Well, if I was on this machine all day long, I'd do about 1 foot 6 a day. We used to love doing pattern carpets. We never used to like plain carpets because it was very boring. I think handmade carpets was beautiful. I think they were much better than the carpets that's made today on the looms.
Thank you.
The gentle downland of the Wylye Valley makes perfect pasture for sheep. Today, much of the area has gone to corn. As a result, the carpet makers at Wilton have to go much further afield for their raw materials. Veteran shepherd Percy Bundy from Codford can remember the days when sheep still ruled.
Well, it's a lovely country, isn't it? Lovely country. I've lived here now 45 years. I worked on the farm over here for 30 years. Yeah. I was at Durntford 5 years before that. And at Doughton, that's where I started my shepherding, at Doughton. My old dad was a shepherd all his life. Started at 11 year old. I can remember him saying, first day he went to the farm, farmer come out, give the men all orders, look round to my father, and he says, Charlie, I want you to go along my ship. All right, sir, he says. So, after orders had been given, my father's father went across to the shepherd, and he says, now, Shep, my boy's in your hands. He says, if he don't do these, don't catch one under the euro. He said, if he comes home and tells me that you hit him, I'll give him another one. They wanted a shepherd at Doughton, where he was shepherd, so Father talked me into, you know, going there. Well, I was second shepherd then. Then after a while, there was an advert for a head shepherd at Little Durnford, so I applied for that and got the job, head shepherd there. When I started, really, sheep wasn't running the fields, not like they are now. They used to be folded, wet or fine, 7 days a week. You had to go to your sheep pen. And when you got to the pen, the old ladies would shout out, come on, Shep, we want our breakfast. And you'd walk through them and see there was no troubles, you know, and then let them in to have their breakfast. They go in there when you don't want them to go in with them. A good shepherd takes interest in his young. He don't take no notice of loneliness. No. Because I think you treat these sheep like human beings. And they are human beings as far as that goes. If you see what these sheep go through, like lambing time, they're like a woman, you know, human being. They get their aches and their pains. And I've always said, even if it's a sheep, they got to be looked after the same as any human being.
Wylye is still one of the loveliest of all chalk streams. It's a fisherman's paradise, and the scenery on all sides makes up for lack of interest from the trout on a bright July day. Taffy Stevens is a fishing fanatic who's tied thousands of flies and who divides his precious fishing time between the Wylye and his native Wales.
Well, I came up from Aberporth in Wales 20 years ago on relief duty. Came up for 3 weeks and I've been here 20 years. Never went back. Go back occasionally, fishing. See my own mum, but otherwise I'm settled here. I was lucky when I came here. I met some fabulous fly fishermen who converted me to chalk strip fishing. I used to be a downstream fisherman in Wales. There's no use having a good fly unless you can put it on the water correctly. Then you've got to get it to the fish correctly. It's no use throwing it at it, because it'd be away. That's all I need in life is a happy home fishing and purity of the chalk stream. Nice people, country. Can have the towns, I don't want the towns at all. Beautiful valley, excellent scenery. I think God planned this one. Nice agricultural area. Peace, solitude. You've got to look for it. Go up the river. You'll find it if you seek it. It can be a bit hard in the winter, but soon get over it. Lonely, yes. Lonely and happy life. You get to know animals, birds, women with dogs. It is a nice solitude. See, it's not just catching fish, it's being out, meeting people, and the challenge. You against him.
The church bells have echoed across the Wylye Valley for many centuries. They're as much a part of the area as the thatched cottages and the sound of water. At Steeple Langford, Fred Vallis and his team keep alive one of the best of the old traditions.
This is my 59th year. That's a bell ringing. But I've had a certificate for 50 years and that's in the Salisbury Guild. Well, it takes quite a lot of learning. Yes. You want to concentrate all the time. It's no good. You mustn't let your mind wander. The bells really, they're quite a very good peal and, you know, a skilled ringer can get on very well. The young boy, Spencer, well, matter of fact, boy taught him at Wylye. So I enjoy my ringing now as much as I did when I started. Well, I like the valley myself. Seems I say I was born at Wylye and I can work my Wylye at Wylye all my lifetime in agriculture, you know, and. Now I don't want to leave now. I hope I can finish my days at Wylye.
At Great Wishford, there are some stones in the church wall showing the price of bread since the year 1800. The prices have risen just a little since 1800. Recently, Tim Phelps has reopened the old bakery in the village, and today it's producing hundreds of loaves for the people of the valley.
I was looking for a house to live, and it's got planning permission to be put into a house. So my wife and myself came and had a look to put it into a house, seen the old ovens there, and thought, you know, we'd give it a go. The baker, I went and seen him to do the baking. Because obviously, you know, not baker, didn't know nothing about it. So he was more than willing to come and do the baking. On the round the villages, which goes Mondays and Thursdays, Tisbury, Tuesdays and Fridays, the Wylye Valley, Wednesdays and Saturday, local, South Newton and Wilton. These ovens are about 150 to 180 years old, which makes a lot of difference. And I had them tested when we first bought the bakehouse, A professional came and tested the ovens and said they were perfect working order after all those years. They were dirty, though. I had to give them a good clean. We get through about 23 sacks of flour a week, round about there. When we first started off, we were only on 12. So we're going up the ladder. It's old-fashioned baked bread in steam ovens. And today's bread is done in electric ovens, as far as I know. And the steam gives it the fluffy texture. The ovens, the original ovens, what we've got, they were on coal originally, and then they've been changed over to oil ovens, oil fired.
Morning, Aaron.
Morning, Bruce.
Can I have a loaf, please?
Certainly.
What time would you like?
For that little.
All right.
Right.
Nice morning.
Not at all, is it?
No.
Okay, first.
Thank you very much. In July, the hedges of the valley are alive with bees in search of pollen. Not just the bees are busy. Beekeepers like Tony Foyle from Duck Street, Steeple Langford, are hard at work trying to make sure of a really good honey crop.
I'm the third generation in my family. Grandfather before me, father then me. Grandfather would have had the easiest time of beekeeping. What with the flowering crops being grown for fodder, vetches and always clover lays, lovely honey clover. Nowadays, when farming changed, we have to change because we are quite tightly allied to farming. And unless we change, then we don't survive. When they dug up this plain, you see, this was all sheep and wildflowers and, you know, lovely it would have been. But then, of course, the barley came and, of course, it changed and we had to change with it. The type of hive we use is I use a single-walled hive. Semi-modern to my grandfather, but not to my father, he would have had them. And all we merely keep it going now and with the modern methods of doing it, you know. Well, the smoke suggests there's a fire. If it was a fire, they would leave the hive. Well, I've never tried it, mind, but I understand if there was a fire, they'd be charged up with honey, then they would leave the hive and go somewhere else if they're going to be burnt out. That's the theory behind it, of a smoker. Or there'd be 30,000 plus in the, you know, on a good hive, good colony. Especially this time of year when the main flow has just started. And I'm hoping that with that number of bees, I should get no more than £30, maybe £40 a hive off them. So it's not good foraging, but it's adequate, you know.
Is there a queen for each hive?
Just one, yeah. Just one in each hive. Any more than one, then one would have to go under. They'd fight until the strongest one won. And they'd turn her at the front and they'd get started again. They home very well. And when they get in the general area, and of course every hive to them smells different. A strange bee would only be accepted into another hive if it was loaded with honey. If it wasn't, then no way would it get in there to kill it off. We make a nice, comfortable hobby living at it, you know. I sell most of mine at the door. But we don't sell, we eat. Not much by me, but most of the family like it, you know. Since I was born, so don't see me leaving now. Not ever, I don't think.
William Cobbett travelled the Wylye Valley in 1826. He wrote that it was fine, very fine, and singularly bright and beautiful. Everything belonging to it is solid and good, and here things are still conducted in the good, old, honest fashion. It's hard to tell whether that great rural rider would have felt the same today. He would certainly have had some fiery words for the passing juggernauts and for modern architects. But in spite of the changes, the sense of history remains, and the splendour of what must be one of the finest stretches of civilised countryside in the world is an abiding pleasure to those who live there and to those who visit it.